So I'm going to introduce my friend Pat Milligan, a senior partner at Mercer and head of When Women Thrive, to kind of share some of her insights she's been sourcing throughout the day, weave to a lot of those Mercer themes that Pam brought up at the beginning of the day when we first met together. So Pat, come on up.
So emotionally, very hard act to follow. So I'm going to try to lift us back up. I am not from the industry, and there's a part of the day that's making me feel that's good. But I'm actually going to lift you up and take you around the world, because I do think seeing what this issue looks like around the world is critically important. But before I do that, a number of people, this is one of the few times I've been to a place where the majority of the people said, who's Mercer and what do you do? So, and why do you even have an ability to talk about this issue? So I thought I would just share who we are. And what's the perspective we bring? I mean, we have the true honor of working with 28, 30,000 clients around the world, represents 110 million people. We see these issues very globally. I think that is one of the things. While we are in an incredibly important part of the United States, these issues manifest themselves dramatically differently around the world. We've had the honor, and we'll come up with new language, but we have worked with well over 200 global organizations on their people strategy grounded in a diverse and inclusive culture and workforce. And I'll just share, I am not a diversity inclusion person. I'm a mom, a mother, a daughter. I have two sons. I've been a business executive. I've been the CEO of our US business, of our career business. The only reason we got involved in this was because Mercer partnered with the World Economic Forum, and we did the gender analytics for the 10th anniversary of the gender parity study at the WEF, and we were going backwards. So when you look at the representation of women in the workforce globally, we are not making progress, we are going backwards. And we also have the honor that we partner with an amazing organization called EDGE. And EDGE was founded by Klaus Schwab's daughter, and they are the most renowned gender certification organization in the world. And I think EDGE and Reframe could do some amazing things together. So that's the perspective we bring. And one of the things I just would ask you today is everyone who sits in this room sits in a different position of power and influence. And it's very difficult when you see some of these intractable issues to think about what can I do. And so I'm just going to observe, I think together we have to articulate a better business case for gender and diversity in this industry. And why is that important? Because if I can spend a week in Houston last week and hear a male-dominated industry like energy, the CEOs of BHP Billiton, the CEO of Shell, stand up and articulate the business case for gender diversity and inclusion. If those guys in the energy industry can do it, we should be able to do it here. So I just say, number one, I don't hear enough compelling insight into the business case. And I think from a board level, that really matters. And why is that important? If you're a consumer products company, if you're a Unilever, you're a Procter & Gamble, 50 to 60% of your customers are women. Your supply chain is women. You have better safety records if women and other diverse groups run your company. So I don't think we're clear yet. I'm going to call out the ones that I'm struggling with. Clearly, this environment of trust, what we've seen in great companies is they have really made it an environment where you can actually talk about these issues in an incredibly transparent way. You know, my colleague Jill Zimmerman, who runs our talent strategy at Mercer and is our chief inclusion officer, the amount of coaching Jill, you and I were able to give our CEO, who at the World Economic Forum stood up and said, we had a problem. We had a pay equity problem. We were giving women much higher performance ratings and lower promotions. I mean, I thought, Jill, it was amazing that we'd gotten to the point that in an environment that he trusted, that he could actually say, I had a major problem as a CEO, and it took the entire power of the Mercer team to help me solve that. I actually think we didn't have enough time today to really dig into how do we include men deeply in this work. So one of the things I would just share is we have got to make it safe for men to have a conversation about I win and you lose. And why is that important? What's really important is that if you're not in a fast-growing industry, if you're in a low-growth industry, you have to be honest about the fact that to get representation, to get what you need, you are actually going to promote more women and other diverse populations than men. And that just feels like crap. right? I mean, it's just unfortunate that you're at the time in the world where leaders are going to say, I'm going to promote more women, and I'm going to promote more diverse candidates to get the representation I want. And I think we have to be very honest about that. So these issues are all, but the one thing I just wanted to pause on is leadership's a fascinating word to me. And I actually think the most important thing is courageous leadership at every level. And what do I mean by that? I just, again, great honor to see companies, SAP, chairman of the board is a woman, CEO Bill Mcdermott, amazing leader, the CHRO, the chief compliance officer, the leadership and the way they work together on this issue is amazing. And it takes real leaders to talk to each other with real transparency. And it's, and not in anecdotes, but with the data. So we're gonna come back and talk about that. I do want to share that if you haven't downloaded, so one of the things we are incredibly proud of is our When Women Thrive research. And the reason we're proud, because it's not a prevalence study. It's not a basic piece of research. It has 800 organizations, 1.5 million women in almost 50 countries around the world, and it predicts the future representation of women in society and in roles in, and you can look at it through any lens, any industry lens, any country lens. And the reason it's important is because math matters, and it's so depressing, so depressing. So let me just pause. I mean, I just want to pause because, again, you're looking at your industry. This is global data, and it's what does the women in middle management and above from the decade, it was 2015, but 2017 to 2025, by 2025, literally 40% of the population engaged in active work will be women. We will never get to the point where we have gender equality in terms of representation of women in the workforce in my lifetime, ever. So let me pause. I mean, why is that important? Because one of the things Mercer really says is set realistic goals. Really set realistic goals. Know what does it actually mean in your organization for success in gender representation, and don't use language that actually is not actionable. So the word equality, parity, there isn't a single industry we work with that is going to achieve equal gender representation in the workforce in the next decade. So think about that again. Just think about that. So, I mean, that is remarkable to me. And one of the things that we see globally is the countries that are really making progress, Japan, Germany, Canada, are the countries where there are no worker replacement ratios. There are just not enough human beings, right? So where is society really moving this? It's when you live in a place like Japan and you realize if we do not bring women and older workers back into the workforce, we have no economy. We have literally no growth in our economy. So I don't know, I mean, that can be a very depressing scenario, but we don't get depressed about it. We actually, let me share another, again, in the spirit of my good colleague, Min Park, and to see if you were in the room with them. This is one of the things in life I never thought I would love because I'm not an actuary and I'm not a lawyer, but this is our internal labor market analysis, right? This is this 1.6 million women around the world. Let me just pause. I mean, the world looks like this everywhere. So we talk about this industry. What this literally shows you is let's look at how are women and men coming into organizations? How do they get promoted? Where do they fall behind from a pay perspective? How are they leaving? And there is literally no industry around the world where the top two levels are not either 20-80 or 25-75. So is that, I mean, do people internalize that? So we're really, this is almost an intractable problem. And what we heard today in this industry that's exciting is women at the top make a huge difference. So I'm just gonna talk about, you know, the experience at Davos, right? So when Christine Lagarde talks about what is she doing in the financial services sector to ensure women's representation, when the CEO of GM and the CEO of PepsiCo and the CEO of eBay, when they are all women and they manage this data, they fundamentally demand different representation. So there is no question that women in those leadership roles and women CEOs make a huge difference. One of the first things that Ginni Romney did was to look at this data and to say, I will not allow this to go on for another decade. So I'll just pause again. Jill and I, when we started doing this work together, we had a CEO, Julio Portalatin, came in 5 years ago, and I won't say what word he is, but he said, are you blanking me? But our data was horrific. And what did he do? He did a couple of amazing things. He basically made me, as a senior executive, fully accountable for my data. I had to show him every year what were the performance ratings of my women, what was the pay, who got promoted, who didn't. And actually, I got held accountable for that data, I got compensated for that data, and there were men in chairs next to me who didn't deliver on the promotion and representation who got taken out of their roles. I mean, that is true accountability, that if you weave this into how you manage your business, it makes a huge difference. So our number one, you know, no matter what chair you sit in, and I know it's harder if you're in a guild and you don't have access, know your data, know what problem you're really trying to solve, because for us, that makes a huge difference to actually attack the root cause. I also, you know, think if you're an individual or an organization, I don't have the time today to do the kind of coaching that we do for women, but I will share that one of the most intractable issues right now is the courage for younger women to ask the tough questions. So I'm gonna just pause on my own story. So I've had the honor of having two amazing young men, two sons who married two amazing women. And so a year ago, my oldest son and his girlfriend, now his wife, both went to the Stanford Business School. So I can't think of an environment where women should be more secure about who they are than the Stanford Business School, like 10,000 applications, you know. So I go to this seminar, they asked me to run a seminar on when women thrive, and the women in the room were 54% of the population. So here they are, second year, 54%. I asked, how many of you are interviewing right now? How many of you, all hands go up. How many of you have offers? How many of you have multiple offers? I asked the simple question in the interview process, how many of you asked, what is your pay equity philosophy? And are you paying men and women coming into this company, men and women from Stanford, the same pay? Let me, what hands went up in that room? How many women at the Stanford Business School actually were willing to ask a question, what is your pay equity philosophy, and do you actually keep track of your pay equity and share it in a transparent way?
Zero.
So, you know, why was that incredibly, that was incredibly discouraging to me, because I'm thinking, if these young women who are actually the many of the most talented, most sought after women, if they're not gonna ask that question, then I'm not doing a good enough job. And the number one thing they said to me is, if I asked the question, I wouldn't get the job. So just in terms of safety and and my point was, then they do not deserve you, and some company does. So I think my message to the younger women here is, this will not change unless you demand and have these conversations. If you're not asking your manager, tell me at every level in the organization, how are we actually assessing and managing pay equity? So it's a huge, huge issue. I wanted to just pause on, what does our research, so is there a roadmap or a toolkit or anything that you can take away that complements what Reframe is doing? And I would say there are really six major things our research proves. And one of the things is very difficult for people to actually connect, is it's a combination of individual and organizational interventions. So on the individual side, what we saw in our research were that organizations where there was a deep, deep passion for gender equality and diversity, from the board to the CEO to senior executives, but to middle management, the most important determinant is not how does the CEO feel, how does the board feel, is do the majority of middle managers, men and women, have passion about the role that diversity and inclusion plays in their business and why they are a better organization and more successful. So it's passion, deeply personal. So you can actually assess through lots of different employee assessment process, is this something that you personally care about? And by personal, do I show up? If I'm a guy, do I participate in these efforts? Are all of the business resource groups just women, or do men show up? And the one that, now that I'm in my early 60s, I feel exhausted about is perseverance, right? The thing we saw was that it took a sustainable perseverance that passed from CEO to CEO, from executive to executive. But that combination is not enough. The companies who got to equality had both the individual pieces we talked about, but they had amazing systems. So proof, they were relentless about the workforce analytics, about the data analytics. They knew their talent pipeline. They knew who were the women and other diverse candidates who were at risk. Process, they prosecuted the data. You know, the data was something they used constantly. And they were amazing about not only implementing programs, right? So one of the things as an HR consulting firm that we get chagrined about is, you know, when someone says, come design me a new paternity benefit, bring me a new. The reality is most of our clients have great programs, but the culture doesn't support the use of those programs. So if you have an environment where people believe they will be disadvantaged if they work remotely, if they take advantage of these programs, the programs themselves will not do anything. So it's the combination of individual leaders who people say not only are they passionate, you know, is this personal, but they've really persevered through some really tough times. When the going gets tough, when the economy turns, what do they do for their women? And what do they do for other diverse candidates? And then as an organization, they have a muscle, a sustaining muscle. They really prove that they're making progress. They have great processes, and then they support them with excellent programs. So, you know, it is, you know, it's a hard day to actually, and I actually do struggle every year at this day. I'm not a big fan of this day, but every year I step back and say, why am I hopeful and why am I optimistic? And I'll just end with, you know, look, there are times that we have the honor of seeing these inflections, and this year at the World Economic Forum, we have hosted our When Women Thrive breakfast for 5 years. We started out with 26 people at a breakfast, and now we're at 260. We started in a room that had less than 20% men. This year, 48% of the audience were men, and of those men, half of them were CEOs and senior political leaders from around the world. And these were not men that were there with lip service. They were the CEOs of the most powerful companies. I was laughing this year because Pam knows this. We were arguing about who would actually get on our panel, the CEO of Salesforce or the CEO of Unilever. So we're like, okay, that's a good problem. But I want to just point out that I am worried about the backlash issue. I mean, we talk about this a lot, and I think as an HR firm, we are working really hard to get a sense of how will the backlash really manifest itself, because Kelly, my good friend from that, was actually, I think we're really right on the cusp of an unintended backlash. So we're going to monitor that. We're really going to work hard to study that. But I'll leave you with my deep belief that it is intentional progress. It's intentional work. This is not work for the weak of heart, soul, or mind. And it takes an incredible emotional movement like we just saw. But I do think that we know how to make the progress. We really are excited to partner, Pam, with Reframe. I think their framework is excellent. I think our analytics and some of our deeper assessment things can really help. But on behalf of the Mercer team, it's just really an awesome privilege to see the progress and the commitment. And our hope is if we're here next year, we'll have that data for this industry. So I think it'd be great to really have the When Women Thrive survey for this industry, have the internal labor market data, and to celebrate, you know, each year, are we actually making progress in the way that we, I think we have seen in other industries. So on behalf of my colleagues, thank you guys so much.